This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today we have with us someone who I would count as a very old friend. Fran Shaw has been involved in the Gurdjieff work for many, many, many years. I think perhaps more than me, and I've been involved in it in one way or another for a long time, since 1969. Fran has created a remarkable book, and oh, she's been on Dreamland before some years ago. So subscribers, if you look up the name Fran Shaw on the site, you will find her previous interview. She's written something remarkable called I Am Stories, and they are about a series of experiences at a retreat in Switzerland. And I'll set the scene by describing from the back pages of the book exactly what that meant and was like. On a summer's day, a group of Americans arrive at a chalet in Switzerland for a week on retreat with a rare guide. Each of them hears the call of the higher. Yet who among them, despite baggage and type, crosses the threshold to awaken? At any moment, is there enough attention to join with the vital force of life? It's a bumpy week, the tug of beliefs and self-image, yet an indescribable energy, usually hidden, brings an entirely new state of being. As their guide puts it, with attending to presence, allowing a higher force to enter, staying collected, returning, we can live in a new way. And one of the things we're doing on Dreamland more and more every year is inquiring of serious spiritual searchers and journeyers. Just what are you doing? What does this mean? And I think, Fran, I can only say this. Welcome to Dreamland. And I think that, folks, we're going to have a remarkable journey today. Can you begin by telling us a little bit about the inception of the book? Because I know you mentioned to me off the air that you had these stories in hand for over 20 years, and you just decided to put them down. And that's a remarkable journey, this book. Tell us a little bit about how it got started and where you were.
So I'm going to use the word I a lot here, but think of it as the lowercase I. So I'll go into a story.
Okay.
A Fran story. I was at a retreat several times, several summers during the 1990s with a rare guide in Switzerland, the highest inhabited village in Switzerland. And being a writer my whole life, I decided after some of these summer retreats to interview by phone some of the people that were there with me. And I got from them their experiences at the retreat with this guy working in this particular discipline. So in the after the year 2000, I thought, let's write up these interviews into some little stories. Then it just didn't seem like there was a reason for these stories to find their way into a final form and be published. I really didn't understand what they could do in the world, what service they could give, except to give these individual people's personal accounts of something that happened when they were on the mountain with a particular guide. Then during the pandemic, when I went into the, as it were, monastery of my own home alone for almost 2 years, also having Zoom meetings with people in this spiritual discipline, it began to occur to me what was happening to many of us, a kind of weariness, a kind of discouragement, a kind of repeating ideas and beliefs from the past, even a kind of self-loathing. It hurt me in the heart. It hurt my heart to hear that. And I thought that I would like to write in the form of short stories so that could be so there could be some humor and some, you know, characterization and some types and some, some interest, something engaging about these stories, something happening in each story that leads to an epiphany or a real moment of transformation, and see if there would be enough consciousness in me to let that appear in the story for these different types of people, 10 different stories. And I realized what the overall intention of the book would be. The first would be to laugh at how caught up we get in our little individual personal stories. We call it in the work identification. You're very identified with the smallest thing. And yet, even as we are, we rise in this community of people who, for this particular week, have the sole intention of discovering what it is to awaken to another level, to another way of being alive, to the dimension, this deeper dimension in us of presence, to an actual taste of what's animating this Fran, this form, this story, then we would really be, it would really be helpful. I wanted people to read the book and feel encouraged and inspired and to recognize that this is possible now and that once there's a taste of this deeper dimension, we really can let beliefs and ideas and techniques and all the things that we've all been through for the last several decades, we can let that go and see if we can simply pay attention to consciousness arising in us, because it's arising in us, not the way we thought it would, perhaps.
No. Yeah. From the book, you say, and this is related to what you've just said, each of us hopes for a taste of real transformation when an unknown dimension suddenly opens. Each wants to live a fully human life. This unknown dimension appears again and again in the stories, but I don't want to ask you directly the absurd question, which is, what is the unknown dimension? Because you wouldn't call it an unknown dimension if it was known. But tell us your vision of a fully human life.
It's more of a human life fulfilled, that there's so much more to this creature than we experience in each moment when we're only listening to this very, very strong automatic, voice in the head. We don't want it to go away. We simply don't want to be identified with it. In other words, we don't want to derive our identity from yes. that voice that we've trusted for many decades as being me.
We want it to belong to us, not to belong to us, to belong to it. Yeah, exactly.
Right. And so when we have even a moment, and it can be, don't have to be in this particular discipline. You may not even have to be in any discipline. We have a moment, you know, perhaps it's looking into the eyes of our 2-year-old child, or looking at the sunlight on the water. And all of a sudden we go wide with our senses. And all of a sudden we're much bigger than just this form. We feel this contact. That's a taste of really more of reality than what we are if we're only thinking, and having all the energy that's here, that's animating all these amazing processes in the body and the marvelous feeling and marvelous thinking, all that life force energy taken up with listening to and believing in whatever the reactive part is saying to us. It doesn't, and if that reactive part is saying to us, I'm not good enough, I can't wake up, then we really have to question its validity. Maybe that's not what we are, who we are, essentially.
Exactly. And you go on here, LeClaire, the guide, who we will not discuss in great detail because the guide has passed from this world, and the last thing he would want would be for a cult to form around his life. So that won't happen. We will not discuss him. LeClaire is not his real name, though, so if you Google it, folks, you won't find LeClaire. All right. He says, all these forces in me that usually have their way in my ordinary state, because there is no higher force there, now all are drawn up in the current of this unknown dimension that we were speaking about a moment ago. Ego features, all are still there, but now they serve. And when they serve the higher force, all is changed. With attending to presence, higher force, allowing higher forces to enter, staying collected, returning, we can live in a new way. What is this mysterious phrase, attending to presence? What does that mean, Fran?
Yes. Well, you know, we have to, there may be degrees of this degree of contact. For myself, now in this moment, presence has a very, very distinct, non-ordinary quality. In other words, as I'm speaking to you, there is a saturation in the light around this body, around in the room. There's a kind of an awareness of deep quiet in the background, in the sounds in the room, a sense of the inhabiting this body, the whole body in this the shape, in the chair, alive. Sound of the voice, so many impressions. It's as if more of who I am is here now.
Yes.
So fuller being, a sense in each second of receiving all of the impressions of what is now. And that being in this kind of receiving mode certainly takes me out of automatic thinking. That just is quiet. It finds its own place. It's quiet now inside. I'm not preparing what to say or thinking of what to say. The attention is with this light, with this finer quality, this unknown something that's arising when we're speaking together, because there's a great wish here to be as awake as possible when speaking, and then, you know, still speak in a normal way. I have no idea whether it sounds normal, but
it sounds fine. It so sounds very normal.
It's like accompanying this form, Fran, with the formless.
Someone is there. Someone is there behind Fran and behind Whitley and behind all of us. And this journey is a matter of letting Whitley or Fran or any of us become the servant of this other presence that has some kind of joy connected with it and has something to do with eternity and is in all of us waiting. Now, I would like to shift a little bit, and without going down too far down the path of his detailed life, tell us a little bit about LeClaire. What was he like? This was a man who had spent his life in a profound spiritual practice, in fact, was born into it. And can you tell us a little bit about what it was like now that he is in his 70s and he's got this very challenging retreat? I mean, it was, you know, you talk about a high village in the Swiss Alps, what a lovely place it must have been. It was a place of profound inner work, and that often is very difficult. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there? In the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. But what was he like as a person? You knew him well, or as well as anyone did.
Yes, it's hard for me to talk about this this one in the past tense.
Why is that? That's a very interesting thing to say. He's still with you.
And you.
Yes, indeed. Indeed. You know, let's take another slightly different direction. When you say contact, when you say that word contact, it means one thing to certain people like me, because I've had contact with other entities that turned out to be pretty much on the same journey we're on. But when you say contact, you mean the living presence of someone like LeClaire, I think, is that correct?
So this is a new area for me.
Yes.
Certainly not one in which I can make pronouncements. The impression has been coming in very strongly, as it is in this moment, that when we begin to awaken and our attention is activated so that each second we can receive impressions of this deeper dimension, more of what we are, this animating quality, we'll call it that. There's no words for these. As someone said, these are pointers. There's only one presence, one life, capital L, one energy flowing through me, flowing through everyone listening, flowing through Whitley. We're all the same, essentially. It's just hidden for the reasons we talked about before. And the same is true for someone who has let the body drop away, as this form has disintegrated for some, but this, the living presence, it feels like, continues. And Whitley, you may even have profound personal experience with this in lifetime.
With my wife, indeed.
And me also. Recently. So, I don't really know anything. What, you know, death, I don't know. It may be just a change in form or no form for a while. Doesn't mean that what's alive ceases to be alive.
That's such a profound statement. It doesn't mean that what's alive ceases to be alive. Fran is talking there about the process of death and summing up in just a few words the reality that this transformation is actually something very much to be looked forward to. Because we've completed something when our bodies stop. And my wife, who died in a conscious state, I would say, was very much aware of the nature of the transition, and then returned in my life and in the life now of many others as a teacher. And I think that Fran alluded to the fact that she's not alone. LeClaire is there, and many, many others. And how do we, Fran, address the experience of being alive in such a way that we attract these teachers to our own needs?
It's really more of just not putting up obstacles.
What are the obstacles?
It really, for me, is the believing in the involuntary thinking, the listening to the voice in the head, believing that is the only identity. That is me. That's all there is to me. And if it's very noisy and takes all of the attention into this really kind of surface activity in the mind going on by itself, you know, making this one feel a certain way or think even more, really go down the rabbit hole. That's the obstacle, because if this space, this huge space that we are essentially is filled with, if it's contracted to just listening to that one little thing and believing that one little thing, how can anything else get through? So we're the, as it were, creator of obstacles when we listen only to self-talk in the head. It's the greatest reminder in the world, our greatest asset, because it reminds me that, oh, my world has shrunk.
Yes. You know that I've like anyone who does the kerchief work, I've worked a lot with the self-talk in the head and trying to listen to it and to let it flow on its own. And when I started back when I was a young man, my thoughts were very, very serious business to me, and what I thought of another person, et cetera, and so forth, and what I thought in general, what I believed and didn't believe. Now it's terribly hilarious. It's the whole thing. I'm always laughing at myself. I have gone from taking my inner voice seriously to enjoying it as a friend with a lot of funny ideas. So where are we with that? Where does humor come into the joy of this journey?
Well, it's really very funny, this identification.
Yes,
sometimes,
exactly.
Sometimes, you know, at that very vulnerable period in the middle of the night, 3 a.m., you know, when you're stirred from sleep because of the planetary pain, possibly, that is something, you know. And there's that, whatever it is, that happens. And sometimes and then the mind starts picking up, starts saying things. Sometimes I hear myself say, really, are you going to run that old story again?
Exactly.
I say aloud to really, are you going to put me through that old mind pattern, that old story about this one or that one or this again? It always makes me feel awful. So, you know, that's a toe in the door, because that means that there's something that's not completely taken by the story that wants to run. And that's the opportunity, and how successful one is in this moment depends on a lot of things, but it's like, well, three breaths, just breathe is a big one for me. This is just breathe.
It's freeing.
To follow the breathing, because it's hard to be thinking if you're actually trying with the attention. Mobilize attention just enough to follow a few breaths. Maybe then the ears start to open and become sensitive, and there's a listening to the quiet of the night or the noise, the sounds of the night. Anything to shift into a wider, expanded sensory perception. That kind of, even just seeing oneself as if there's a camera on oneself, the body as an object, a second of that, anything like that makes it possible for enough space to appear for the consciousness to arise, for another dimension to open. If it doesn't, okay, you're going to get a lot more opportunities.
Right. That's the thing. Life gives you opportunities all the time, every second. My new book, Jesus, A New Vision, is not a Christian book. It is not an anti-Christian book either. Very much not an anti-Christian book. It is new, genuinely new. A look at Jesus in his life and what happened afterwards, his resurrection. For the Shroud of Turin is no medieval forgery. It goes all the way back, and it does record an extraordinary event that appears to have been a body transforming into a form of coherent light. The science is very strong at this point. And yet, how could that be? What an extraordinary mystery. The life of Jesus is mysterious indeed, but the greater part of the mystery is about us. How is it that a human body could transform in that way? Who
accomplished it? Why did it happen? What does it mean to you and me about our lives now? Jesus, a new vision, a new window into a very old way of looking at the truth, a way of finding ourselves, perhaps, that we lost a long time ago, but can recover. Jesus, a New Vision is available in Kindle format, as a paperback, in audiobook format on Audible and Apple, and as a Kindle and paperback on Amazon. Do go and get it today.
In the book, you mention you have a sentence that's germane to this discussion, and we can advance it another step at this point. Just a moment. I need to make little notes as I go along so that when we're finished, the sound editor will know what we've done or not. And since I'm the sound editor, those notes are very important to me. You make this statement, on the mountain, many of us experience for the first time the difference between something we do and something we receive. Now, all of that stuff that we've been talking about going on in the head and the 3 a.m. awakening when you, oh, God, what am I going to do that? I used to do that. Now I get awakened at 3 a.m. for an entirely different purpose, but my listeners know about that. We're not going to go into that now. What is the difference between something we do and something we receive? Fran, that's a very interesting sentence, because I have the sense that there's a lot sort of out there and in here waiting to give itself to us, and we kind of push it away with this doing.
I think that once we have this, even this idea, this magnificent idea that possibly we're mechanical or automatic or victims of sleep, is another word, you know, yes. And that there's awakening possible to another way of being alive, to a higher level, a fuller level. We have lots of tools, which are all doings, and they're very useful to start moving in the direction of awakening. All of the meditation and yoga and all the things that hundreds of thousands of us are doing now as consciousness is arising on the planet are wonderful. Doing yoga, you have to be in your body and sense your body so you don't hurt yourself, for one thing, and so you can, you know, take these positions and yoga, Tai Chi, Gurdjieff work. We have sensing exercises where we sense each limb in succession, for example, to try to come back into sensing the body so that attention can mobilize and have a ground where it can stay for a little bit. That's what we need, to be bring attention into the whole body. We bring it down from the head. We bring it down into the whole body. And then all of a sudden we feel, oh, well, wait, I'm alive now. This is like a foot in the door. Then we just need to have a certain kind of sensitivity appear that's no longer really a doing. It's more of a, as I was saying before, an expansion of even sensory awareness, so that letting more impressions come in, instead of going out to everything, letting impressions come in. So again, as I'm speaking, there's the quiet in the room behind me, and there's a quality of light here, and there's the sensation in the jaw, and what the hand is doing, and the posture, and where there's muscular tension. None of the content is important. And certainly not something to get hung up about. No, that's just something to be aware of, to mobilize attention here so that I'm here now. And then, well, what more is here? Aside from the muscular tension in the body, for example, is there any quality of energy flowing through the body? And can I be aware of these subtler impressions now that I'm here in the body for a moment? It's these really subtle impressions of what's flowing through the body and all around that, again, allow more and more for this other dimension to open. And then to recognize it when it appears and to pay attention only to that, at least now, only to this, what is arising. For me, it's the way out of suffering, the only way out of suffering, to find this thread, and it can start with just following a few breaths and trying to be more and more sensitive and open to what's animating this form that's speaking.
LeClaire says, speaking of attention, if it is my attention, the one that runs up the mountain, sees obstacles, does this or that, it is not this other attention which transforms. What he models for us is a heightened sensitivity to a finer energy, higher intelligence, this sacred attention, he calls it, the teacher in you, the teacher in me. And even subtler energies can come into you. The light can come into you. My wife used to laugh and say, you read, Whitley. Why don't you just relax and listen to your own teacher? He's been waiting there all of your life. So tell us about that teacher. I know you know that teacher pretty well. Or not.
It's wonderful once there is a taste, as there can be right now in this moment, with a listening to the quiet as well as to the voice, just let more and more of the impressions come in now of the body and senses, receiving rather than doing, just receiving, letting it come in. There's a moment of a real shift in identity, so that the form almost seems to be like a much less solid, you may notice, much less solid and of much less interest, because something so alive and vibrant and with qualities of loving and joy to it begins to arise. This is what I mean by being held by the presence that's in all of us. And the presence, this, which is what we are, essentially, can be the teacher now for us, especially when we've been working for so many decades. Or even if we haven't been working for so many decades, it's the same in all of us.
Yes, it is, right.
It's here now. It's always here, always available, often calling to us. So it's this one is unskillful, you know, Fran's sort of unskillful. It takes a while perhaps to recognize what is necessary and what's not necessary in order to allow awakening to arise.
To allow awakening to arise. Passage, the story. This book is built out of stories that Fran remembered from her time at the retreat. And they're stories, basically, as she said earlier, that she got from other people at the retreat. And one of them is called Alice's Bookshelf. And something in that story is very relevant to what we're talking about right now. LeClaire says, these ups and downs we go through when we're self-centered. We are all like this, experiencing associations, frustrations. To let that be, but to feel some pure attention, even as you are suffering, tired. A beautiful landscape. So remarkable when there is, along with that, a moment of attention quite different. And the seeing, this contact with pure attention, is freeing. And then Alice hears, life can be distressing, but the light of consciousness can be in me. And, you know, we live in a world, Fran, which is so filled with all kinds of knockings and bangings of conspiracy theories and politics and fears of war and rumors in the night of all kinds. But this other attention, this pure attention, is freeing. What exactly is the feeling you get when you know that you have allowed this pure attention to emerge in you?
One is that it is not mine, thank God.
Thank God.
That it's not something that can be manipulated by little me, thank God. That it is, if we want to use religious language, it is finding oneself in God, in Lord. That's one feeling. Another is that a quality of this particular, let's call it fine energy, is a lovingness that is not mine, a compassion that is not mine, but of the nature of the quality of this very alive, call it vibration, whatever, these are pointers. So that for a short while, everything and everyone in the world is accepted as is. The ones that are causing great harm are just like me when I'm asleep and cause great harm. That's coming out of wounds, it's coming out of suffering, it's coming out of a hunger for this that can't be found. In my ordinary state, there's a lot of afflictive emotions. I hate what they did. This is the little I.
Yeah, right.
Right?
Right.
Oh, how could you do this? How could you do this with, in all good conscience? And this culture of contempt that is trying to be developed and get hold in this country, which fortunately the younger generation sees through. And no, we really do not want to hate anybody else for what somebody tells me they are. I don't think so.
No.
So, I have great respect for the younger generations because I feel they have they already have what it took us 40 or 50 years to begin to feel.
That's very true. If there is hope in this species, it's them.
And
my grandson, who is 14, is very much like that. He's so filled with an incredibly rich and complex compassion, even at that age, that it seems as if he's been living for 1,000 years, and maybe indeed he has. Now, in the story, when Ego left town, there is a phrase, a little sentence here. Yes, I wish to have this. To give you a background on this story, it's about a man who's called Nicholas in the book, who finds someone he dislikes intensely and has fought with, is there at the retreat, and must now live and work with him, even though he despises him. And this is a very familiar situation, believe me, for all of us. I parenthetically, before I go on, I would like to say what happened when I asked my wife after she died, what is compassion? Because it's been such a curiosity for me to understand this remarkable state. And she answered me indirectly, but very powerfully, when she said, each of us is all we have. Now, LeClaire in the man asks, says to LeClaire, we were friends, speaking of the one, we had a fight. I moved away. I haven't seen him since. We were friends for years. I've known him since Catholic school. I should have some compassion. And that compassion extends not just to a friend with whom you've had a fight. It extends to everyone that you overlook, don't notice, or reject, all in the world, including all of the people who disagree with you politically and spiritually and all everything, everybody who's done you harm and who has done you good. LeClaire's answer is this. Yes, I wish to have compassion, but it isn't me that can have compassion. It is this intelligence in me that can have compassion. I see my friend acting this way and that, but I observe, open, so this sacred attention appears, and then all of me serves that, obeys that. And the man, Nicholas, says, instead of ego, you mean? And LeClaire replies, ego is that which separates me from others. Now, at that point, I think I would like you to talk to us about your experience and journey when it comes to compassion.
Very rare, very rare. Always in moments of fuller being, always in moments of being joined with this, as was said, sacred attention with a capital A, not my attention, but my attention joined with this higher intelligence, capital I, what we are, essentially. All of us the same. There's a certain amount of pain associated with how the heart is closed, usually possibly out of, you know, quote, self-protection. And it really touches me to see the little ones, 1 year old, 2 years old, who have not developed ego, who don't have personality in the fore, who are not even listening to thoughts or beliefs in their head, but who are still here. And the empathy they have for every living creature, the natural goodness that's there, that's in us still, just got covered up. Ego had to develop so that now it can recede, now it can take its possible place of less dominance, less domination, because it doesn't taste right now. It doesn't taste right. Maybe it's the quality of presence to come in the day as often as possible. But when you know, ego comes out strongly. It doesn't taste like the real, the true, what we are. It maybe it's a like self-image, just a mirage, just a bubble that we're convinced is us, another identification. I'm sure that's what it is, but doesn't mean that I don't fall victim to it during the day a lot. I'm not beating myself up about it, though, because you see how the attention has this miraculous possibility to join with an even finer attention that's not mine. At any moment, there can be listening, a wide listening. There can be a sensing of the body, and there can be a sensing of or an awareness of what's animating the body, the voice, the listening, the thinking. So the heart opens is all I can say. When the heart opens, there's a human being here for those seconds. And I'm so grateful for that. Possibly, maybe I don't do any harm to others in that moment.
Yes, it's a challenge to look back upon one's life and see the subtle harm and taking that one does so often. But yet, this other attention that you speak of, LeClaire has a very interesting statement in one of the stories, The Most Natural Thing in the World. He says, being with the greatness of nature, another quality appears, another self, connected to something outside time and space. The joy you feel, not for you, but to connect you, as in prayer. And we are so disconnected. And isn't that all of that struggle that we were just talking about related to this fundamental disconnection? And we can reconnect so easily because nature is all around us. I live in a little apartment with not even enough of a deck for our garden, but I can step outside and nature is there. There's a lovely tree at the end of the walk. It's an old tree. But and it's a humble tree. It's not very big, and I don't think anyone would call it a glorious, beautiful tree. But it's my friend, that tree. And so I have nature there, right outside. You don't need to go to the Grand Tetons or Yellowstone to be in nature, is my point. But talk to us a little bit about this joy, not for you, but to connect you as in prayer.
So any living creature in the house or outside the window, I myself have a particular plant on a landing as I walk down from the bedroom downstairs. And I usually stop and look at this plant because it's so quiet. It's so alive and so silent. And it says a lot about my state when I get out of bed and run down the stairs and don't see that plant, and a lot about my state, which is helpful, when there can be, looking at it, taking it in, with no thought about naming it or what it is. Just this aliveness that's here and silent. The same thing we love about looking in our dog's eyes or our cat's eyes. Sometimes you just feel the consciousness, the pure consciousness that's there. Being with a tree of any size, a flower of any size, anything that's alive in nature, that's, you can feel a silence in that being. And what they are and what you are is one. So all of that is the teacher as well, because the presence in them, the aliveness, the life force, again, these are pointers in them, is what is touched in this one, in me, when looking at it, looking at the sky, looking into the face of someone you love.
Yeah. Annie used to say, when I would ask her, she always, her mantra was have joy, which is the only thing my visitors ever said to me in clear language in my whole life. And she picked up on it immediately. And she used to say, getting that television that you've been wanting is happiness. Looking into the eyes of a baby is joy. That's the difference. So you've mentioned babies before, and I know that they're much a joy in your life as they are in the life of all of us older people. Seeing is a blessing, says LeClaire. It is never negative. It is objective. It comes from above, and it comes with that attention that we've been discussing that does not belong to us, but is us and of us at the same time. Can you tell us about what this word objective means?
The simplest way to understand it in this moment is to have this impression of the body being seen as an object, just this shape in a chair, as if something, almost as if there maybe is a camera on it. So all of a sudden, this body is an object. Like any object in the room, it's not that there's no feeling about it. It's just that it's more like there's an impartiality. There's no judgment about it. It's here. It's in this shape. Being objective, or working towards having an objective impression of things, requires a couple of things. One is no judgment, which, of course, the talking mind is constantly judging and reacting. So it does require mobilizing enough attention. Again, this body being seen in this shape, however the muscles are tensed, however the head is tilted, you know, whatever the bend in the elbows, the bend in the knees, the bend at the ankles, just the body is an object. This kind of seeing of the body mobilizes attention and allows for a little bit of impartiality in this moment, because Fran isn't thinking about the body, but actually having an impression that it's under observation, it's being seen just as it is.
Yes.
This is key, because otherwise we, if we start looking at our thoughts, our feelings, we just go down the chute, because it's we get very involved in the content. When I'm learning about Fran, when I'm learning about this form, I get, become very excited and involved with it, which is okay for a time, but it's not the quality of objectivity that comes when the mind is quiet and there's no thinking, so there's no judgments, because the interest in this moment is, and again, receiving impressions of the light and the sound and being more present.
Yes.
Out of the content, whatever you're present to, that doesn't matter.
No.
The sun doesn't care if an ant is crawling across the rug. The sun just shines.
Right, yes. The sun just shines. And what Fran is saying, there's something in it that I want to bring out a little bit. It's so important. In 99.9% of all meditation exercises, mindfulness exercises, you start with relaxing the body. That's not what the sensing exercise is about. It's a matter of seeing it as it is, not relaxing it, but looking at it in its state of tension and its perpetual state of readiness, because it's always ready. And when you do that, it's a very extraordinary experience. It's hard to do because, you know, as soon as you see your oh, my arms or my face is tense or my this or that, you know, you try to relax into it. But when you see it, it's this other attention that Fran is talking about that sees it. And all of a sudden, you have the chance of being something truly new in your own life. Waking up. It's, waking up is not, we live in a consumer society, so we always think, well, if only I was awake, everything would be absolutely beautiful. No, it's not true. When you are awake, it's a process of noticing everything as if it was truly new. We beat ourselves up. And LeClaire goes on in this extraordinary passage, in this extraordinary book. Beating myself up is something else, he says. Now, the context is this. Tom, the fellow that Nicholas was grumbling about earlier, is struggling. He says, I'm dead asleep most of the time. I'm really a slave to my thoughts, continually after one another. And everyone would think, of course, I am too. And LeClaire's response is basically, don't beat yourself up. He says, he looks directly at Tom and he says with great kindness, where is the love? Where is the love? The room becomes still. There's a tenderness in the air because everyone is feeling the same thing. I have that love in me. And then he says, put down the whip. Once you put down the whip and quit bellyaching about yourself, you begin to come free, and it begins to return to the joy that we spoke of earlier, of seeing yourself as you are, not only letting the tensions in your body be as you sense them, but letting the rest of yourself flow as it is, as you watch. This is allowing this higher attention to come into our life.
Because this intelligence, capital I, this other attention, there's no judgment in it at all.
No, none.
A loving quality. So why would Fran judge a part of Fran? You know, it's like maybe if it motivates one in a certain time to wish to become conscious and then actually begin to, you know, breathe, listen. Anything can be great as a motivation, but it's a great relief to discover, as you've been saying, that the body doesn't have to be a certain way for awakening to take place. The feelings, the thoughts don't have to be a certain way. I don't have to sit in a certain way, or, you know, thank God, because I'll die, and who knows what I'll be like then. I don't have to be a certain way in order to wake up. Relaxation is an extraordinarily useful tool at certain times, because sometimes it's difficult to sense the body when it's very tense. And we're trying to sense not just muscular, large and small muscles, or how they're configured, or where there's tension or whatever, but what's animating the whole body. It's a very subtle impression. So I can understand why completely relaxing the body with the intention of sensing even something subtler than the flesh of it And who knows what the flesh is also. But relaxation can be useful. So none of the things that we've done or are doing are not useful. What's important is not to get identified, not to believe completely in the belief system, the form of the system, the exercise, the techniques. Once there's a taste of living for a few seconds in this non-ordinary state that's absolutely unmistakably recognizable when it appears, and it's not the ordinary self at all. Once there's a taste of that, then that's the teacher, more than anything, more than any story that's going on in the head. There's no past to it. There's no future that I have to work towards. As was said earlier, it's like really stepping out of time into this dimension where there's no content, no time. I must sound like a school marm. That's the university.
Not at all, Fran. Not at all.
University professors lecturing now.
Well, we'll shift our attention into another direction then. But it's really flows from where we have been. This is in the story, All the Other Voices. Angie is the speaker in this story. My husband died 2 months ago. It was sudden. It changed the way I look at everything. I'm a crying machine these days. It's like I don't want to be in the world anymore. My husband, her friend Paulina responds, is off planet. It's been a year, says Paulina. He's just with me in a different way now. What do you mean? At first, it took me a while to realize I can talk to him and he actually responds in my head. I shouldn't be saying any of this. Then she continues, I'd be sure it was him. Then later, I'd doubt it. It seemed too good to be true. But things happened that were so amazing. I just knew it was him showing me he's still with me. I mean, I couldn't make up these things. What does he say? Different, but wonderful. And then she pauses and she says, maybe like LeClaire says, we really are multidimensional creatures. It feels that way. And now I know you, just like me and Anne, you have a relationship and more than one relationship, just as I do, with people who are no longer in the physical world. How in our journey toward awakening are we to take these relationships as usefully as possible?
Of course, it's difficult to sort out what is imagination and what is actually really taking place. It helps if there's a sense of what's real and what's not real with this thing, with this one exactly. Form that we are, you know. I mean, I don't even know what the body is. William Blake, the mystic poet, centuries ago said and I've said this to you, Whitley, that the body is simply the soul as perceived by the five senses in this age.
Yes, I thought that was a brilliant insight.
So, and of course they used body, capital B, and soul, capital B, in centuries ago. It meant something possibly different, but still, it's like we sometimes have this experience of the body being not oh so solid. What is incredible about this possible true contact with people who are not in this form of a human body on the planet anymore, it seems, is that it somehow takes away the fear of death.
Oh, yes, it does indeed.
And that's, it's like, I don't have enough time to wake up now, because, and I'm going to die like a dog, which we've been told. And then you're thinking, well, wait a minute. I don't know if that's going to be complete. Maybe I will die like a dog, but maybe not. It seems as if I shouldn't talk any more about this. Everyone needs to find his or her own way with this. And it helps to know whether or not I'm here in this non-ordinary way, receiving impressions of this deeper dimension that we've been speaking about now. Yes. In this moment, the only moment we have.
Mr. Gurdjieff said, and there's one of his books is entitled, "Life is real only then when I am." And this occurs in the story, as in the story, the two women come to that question that you have just brought. The chimes from the village church sound the noon hour. As Angie listens, her in-breath and out-breath align with each note ringing, I am, I am, I am. And it's delicious out there on the balcony with her bare legs outstretched. All her problems, what do they matter now? As she sits like this in the sun. And it's important to remember, folks, how simple this whole thing is. What's complicated is finding our way out of the labyrinth that tells us we're asleep. What's simple is giving up the labyrinth entirely and realizing I'm not asleep. I'm somewhere, I'm something else. I am. I know you use this phrase, I am, so much in your talk and your work and our conversations together, Fran. Tell us what it means to you now, after all of these years of exploring the boundaries of and the boundarylessness of those two words.
The title of the book is I Am.
Yes, I know.
Stories, lowercase, meaning these are stories of the I Am. These are stories of, we'll use other words, Lord. These are stories of presence. These are stories of capital C consciousness, pure consciousness arising in us. These are stories of, as Rumi would say, feeling that moment of your wings lifting. These are stories of, as Rumi would say, joining the moving river of presence. These are stories, as Walt Whitman would say, I am not contained between my hat and my boots. That phrase refers to the deeper dimension. And so what I am is not stories. I am not stories. Right. I am not stories. There's no content in I am, whatever comes and goes, I Something is speaking through from this deeper dimension.
Speaking through. There is a word we haven't used yet, but we're going to do it now. The word is surrender. And the outer person in our world wants things. We're consumers. We want a new car. We want a croissant, a cup of coffee. We're human. Why wouldn't we? Of course we do. There's nothing wrong with it. But there is something else. You can't consume this attention that we're talking about. You have to surrender, open. What does that mean to you, this surrender?
Well, first, there has to be a recognition that it is appearing. That something is appearing now that is usually hidden. That's usually not paid attention to. We're not taught how to pay attention to it in school or probably by our parents. And we come into a world where people are mostly asleep, meaning this other dimension, this multidimensional existence is not experienced too much. Yet we have come into this world possibly for this purpose, to awaken in these circumstances. So to surrender for me means only one thing, that in this moment there's a recognizing, second by second, this quality of light that is here, subtle, but when noticed, becomes saturated and very prominent. And then having the mind take its rightful place of monitoring the connection with this, the contact with this. So I guess what is surrendered is identification with thinking, with, you know, the usual stuff that's going on, but only because there's something much more compelling on the scene right now. You see, it's not that we have to get out of the labyrinth. Even if we laugh at it, even if we have enough seeing to notice, really, how, you know, I laugh at myself when identified, because it really is, it's bizarre sometimes.
It really is. You get so stuck on things.
Really? You know, and there's a lot of jokes in the book, as you know. I don't know if people think you, I mean, because
it's full of humor. It's full of fun, actually. Yes, indeed.
People tell me, because I sneak it in there. So laugh at how, you know, we've made an elephant into a flea and a flea into an elephant, you know.
Right.
You know, it's like just these funny little things about human nature. So you begin to notice them, and then you can sort of be joke about them, and then you're not caught so much by them all the time. So I hope that readers will just laugh out loud. I try to put something in every page, every other page, where that's just surprising. The line you don't expect. She sighed heavily, like she just moved the piano.
Exactly.
He looked at him like he's speaking in tongues. Do I sound like I'm speaking in tongues now? they're all over the place because it's we could absolutely enjoy the labyrinth. We could enjoy everything that this form is, this marvelous mind that enjoys so many things, and this wonderful heart that can love and appreciate, this body that's like the just will soldier on no matter what we do to it. I mean, really stewards of this earth and of the earth. We can be that way. It's just a very subtle noticing of this unknown force that can appear when my attention mobilizes enough and comes into the wider field of impressions of what's here. And then, well, wait, what's trying to appear? What is trying to arise? It's wonderful. I mean, it's wonderful. The tears can be there. The grieving can be there. The anger can be there. All of it is just, if there's something that can even just letting the seeing be there, just, okay, this is how it is. I don't have to change anything about the form. This is the great thing that the presence teaches.
We're going to, I think, conclude with, in the story, the most natural thing in the world, there occurs a passage. There's a team attempting to translate some of Leclerc's writings into English from French. They translate this sentence: there exists inside you an energy of extraordinary intensity. You can perceive its life. You don't have to. And then they don't know quite how to translate the next word. And so Leclerc says, "What's this, you say? Cry crocodile tears?" People chuckle. Even more slang is offered. A few sentences later, Leclerc asks, "What's this mean? Scatterbrained. And what's his chatterbox?" They're all laughing so hard because that word, you don't have to. It could be a chatterbox, be scatterbrained, cry crocodile tears, all of these different things that we do all the time that are at once hilarious when you see them from the outside. But then again, it's an important journey, because this incredible energy that exists inside of us, that is part of the deep sacredness of the body and having a body at all, every single human being, every creature, but most truly every human being who can see this is deeply sacred and blessed. But tell us a little bit about the energy he speaks of and the way it works in our bodies and our lives.
You express it so eloquently, and not necessarily through the words, but I can feel the love in you for consciousness.
I can in you too, friend.
It almost doesn't matter what the words are if you're sensitive to and can feel the love of consciousness. Because you see, it maybe not by words or ideas that we get a taste, but just by aligning, somehow aligning. And when others are aligned with this energy that we all are, that everything that runs through all things, We are one, we are home, we are free for this moment, and this is the only moment that matters, that is where we have this possibility. So it's unknown. This is the beginning of entering the unknown. I don't know what it is. And as T.S. Eliot said, "Oh, do not ask what is it, let us go and make our visit."
Yes, that's one of the quotes in the book. It's such a great one. So good. And you found that quote. It's a wonderful one to use. It was so perfect. It was so perfect.
I know that listening has, whether aware of it or not, made that visit and can make that visit and maybe making that visit now. I mean, consciousness is arising all over the planet now. It's a new possibility. It's so important now, I guess. That's why we're all here and why it's possible.
That's right. And it's why this trajectory of this show has changed so much over time, that now we are engaged in a really serious journey on the show that wasn't possible before, because before, not many people could relate to it. Now, not many people can't relate to it. That's the difference. Well, I think we're coming to the end of our time together, Fran. And I want to first to thank you for the effort you have made today, folks. It has been an extraordinary experience to take this journey with Fran over this time. Her book is I Am Stories, Up at the Retreat, and it is a real treasure. If you are interested in a serious journey toward awakening, there is nothing more fun than to do than to read these stories. They are filled with life and energy, humor, wit, and intelligence and seriousness, all of those things. And we'll end now with a quote that begins the story that from LeClaire. There is a subtle energy penetrating the body, a higher intelligence that I can recognize because I'm a human being. With a very active attention, I can receive this energy. When this energy is there and I am aware of it moment by moment, I begin to be. All my thoughts, feelings, ideas are nothing compared to this precious treasure, this quality of energy that is not mine, but what I am, the living mystery I am, rendered in the form of stories. So we've looked at it in two different ways at the beginning and the end of the book, of the interview. And now perhaps those words mean something very new. I hope they do. Fran, I would like to thank you for being with us this week on Dreamland, and I do hope you come back again soon.
Thank you, Whitley. Thank you, everyone, for listening.
And Fran, let's mention, I've mentioned your website a couple of times before, but can you mention it again?
It's franshawbooks.com.
franshawbooks.com. Well, thank you. And folks, thank you as always for being with us on Dreamland.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.